inspires author Lorrie Potvin? Let's find out. But before we do, if you love books and the stories behind them, please subscribe to my channel. Interviews are posted on Tuesdays, the second and fourth week of every month. Hi, my name is Crystal Fletcher, and welcome to All About Canadian Books. Today's guest is author Lorrie Potvin, and we'll be discussing her memoir, Horses in the Sand. It was published by Inanna Publications, and it's a sequel to First Gear, a motorcycle memoir. Horses in the Sand is a collection of stories that document a queer woman's journey from sparse beginnings to becoming a tradeswoman, teacher, and an artist. And Lorrie rocks. It's a great memoir. I highly recommend it. And welcome to All About Canadian Books, Lorrie.
Oh, thanks, Crystal. I appreciate you having me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure. So one of the things, as I was reading your memoir, Lorrie, when you're writing about becoming a tradeswoman, I was just like, oh my gosh, like what you went through in your journey. You've also been teaching for over 30 years. How has the trades changed, or has it changed for women that are trying to enter to currently?
Well, I think in some ways it's changed in that now you see women on construction sites and they have clothing that fits and they have coveralls that fit. I even think I saw an advertisement once for coveralls that kind of zipped or Velcroed or something out the back so that you could have, you know, access to areas that you need, like that men just have to undo their zipper. But things, simple things like having gloves that fit, you know, good boots and all the protective clothing. So I think advances have been made there, as well as having washrooms available for women and locker rooms available for women. When I first started in the trade, there was neither. I had these big sloppy coveralls and gloves that, you know, extended each finger by an inch. And I had to go use the washroom in the women's, like the administrative building where there was a woman, all women were working in the office. So I'd go use their washroom. And I think it was when they complained about me sort of dirtying it up with dust and paint and stuff, that next thing you know, there was this woman, there was a woman's washroom being built for me in the city of Ottawa garage. So so those things have changed. I do though, that the numbers haven't risen significantly since I was in the trade. And I still think that there's some opposition. And I think it's more like, well, you know, we don't want women to displace men, but we'll make room for. And I think that that is an attitude that needs to change, because women are capable and worthy of those really well-paying good jobs.
And that's what I really loved in your book was, you know, you talked about your teaching experience and also, you know, as you were getting your placements and just how hard you had to work to prove yourself. But once you had done that, you had the respect of the men around you.
Yes. Yeah. I think that there's a lot of assumptions about men walk into the construction site. You know, a man and a woman could walk into a construction site, and there's a lot of assumptions made about the man that they already have the skills, they have the tools, they have the knowledge. And whereas with women, it could be opposite, you know, that the man could have had no experience, where a woman has all kinds of experience and comes with her own tools. But those assumptions are made. And there's also a lot more scrutiny. I found that, you know, men would look at you more, and they'd come by your stall to see what kind of work you're doing. They certainly had an eye on you. And once you proved that you could do the work, then that was like, okay, we got her, you know, I guess we'll take her on.
Yeah. Was there ever a point, Lorrie, where you just thought, oh, like, this is too much. Like, I don't want to do this anymore.
No, because I had that experience of sitting at a desk for 2 years. You know, when I left high school, I couldn't, the only skills that I had were typing in shorthand, because I went to high school in the 70s, and that's what girls did. They took typing, shorthand, home economics, and learned how to sew and set the table for when the man came home for dinner. And so, you know, I sat there for 2 years doing what, you know, to support myself. I needed a job, but it was, so I just loved being active. I loved working in the shop, whether it was a machine shop, body shop, a mechanic shop, welding shop. And I think, so being a hands-on, who learned, hands-on person who, yeah, it was, I never regretted any decision. And yes, it might have been hard, but it was, I knew it was the place where I best fit in.
Another part of your memoir, you talk about your identity. How has your identity, Lorrie, changed over time?
Well, and I think that that's a big part of the memoir that I talk about. Thanks for the question. Yeah, yeah. And it's changed with me as a tradesperson, as an artist, as a writer. You know, I never would have identified as a writer or an artist even 10, 15 years ago, because I didn't think I was worthy of that identification, even though I was, you know, at its simplest form, a writer and an artist. And it's the same with being queer. I think when I grew up, there was a lot of homophobia and the slurs that were used to describe people who were different, who were other than. So as a child, you picked up pretty quickly on, you know, what and who was safe as opposed to not. So, you know, even saying the word, I think, lesbian way back when, you know, 30, 40 years ago would have been, oh, what's that word? That's a bad word. And I had friends who just didn't want to even say that word, you know, when I came out. And so, well, we're gay. And so I, you know, when I started using words dyke and lesbian. And then I finally just decided, well, you know, I am who I am. And I think that comes with age. And so when I talk in my memoir about that journey, that queer journey of coming out, really was this slow opening door, where then when I had the confidence, when I truly was the person that I was born and meant to be, then I started describing myself as being butch and now, you know, two-spirited. Mm-hmm. So identity does change. And with me, it was that confidence, but also dealing with my own homophobia when I was younger, because it wasn't safe to be other than. And so doing the work and understanding myself, where that came from, and then celebrating who I am and being confident in the person that I am has also allowed me to say exactly who I am. And that feels really good.
And I mean, as an artist, you know, what inspires you, Lorrie?
I like rust. So I do some, I make suns and garden art out of harrow discs and old springs and stuff. I have some of those pictures up on my website, but I'm also inspired by, I do carving, soapstone carving and catlinite. So I carve actually ceremonial pipes. And so it's, but it's all hands-on. Yeah. Work and the rust metal kind of is just really a natural, given my, you know, trade in auto body repair and refinishing. Yeah. And welding. And so I try to do that as much as I can. And so I'm inspired by rust, I would say.
And viewers, I'll put links down below in the description box so you can go to Lorrie's website and check out her art. But it really is an interesting how everything is just such a connection of you. Yeah. You also write in your novel about, you know, the violence and the abuse that you and your brother suffered. And you say, Oh, you're right. It was sad that we never had the ability to look beyond the fighting. In our immaturity and naivety, we didn't realize the future would be periods of estrangement and lack of empathy and compassion for others. And, you know, as I was reading, and you talk about how you were very good at hurting each other, and I just thought the level of self-realization and wisdom that you've gotten along your journey. What advice do you have for any other children or adults who are trying to come to terms with their family dynamics?
Yeah, that's a thank you for that and recognizing what it I think takes to get there. I think for me it was the idea of forgiveness, but I think it was forgiveness of self, to let go of that ruminating, you know, that those voices in your head that, you know, you're not good enough and you're not worthy. And also the wish that my life was somehow different. I think that was the biggest forgiveness of all. It's and it allowed space, and that kept me staying as a victim. So I think that in giving up that wish that my life was somehow different also let me go of becoming victim, of being a victim and becoming a survivor. And it really was, okay, I didn't learn the interpersonal skills, the language, the emotional intelligence as a child. I didn't even learn how to, you know, regulate emotions, or what we saw, we imitated. So when you see violence and fighting and arguing, that's how you think the life goes. And so, you know, it was really, for me, it was a question, okay, I want a better life. I want to have less anguish and less resentment and anger. So what do I need to do? And with that, first that forgiveness, and then just becoming more mindful and conscious. And that was, first of all, for me, self-compassion and empathy for me and that little girl within. Mm-hmm. And then that allows, I think that once you take care of her or him, or however you describe yourself, that then you just can blossom from there. And so that would be my advice.
Yeah. Do you feel at peace right now, Lorrie, with your life, would you say?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Other than being a little tired and fatigued sometimes, I'm very happy and grateful where I am today. And I think that expression that I used before is that I feel that I'm closer to the person that I was born today than any other day through my life, in the sense that I think once you become conscious and mindful and want to become better, you understand it, how conditioned you are right from the very beginning, that as a girl, you're supposed to do these things, as a woman, you're supposed to. And I think that drives us sometimes into corners where we can't get out of. And so it's that deconditioning, I think, that I've spent a greater part of my adult life in getting to a place where I, like I said, I'm closer to the person I was born before that conditioning happened, you know?
Oh, that's wonderful. That's really wonderful. Lorrie, thank you so much for being a guest on All About Canadian Books, Migwich. I so enjoyed your time and learning more about you and your journey. For viewers, again, links down below so you can go to Lorrie's website or purchase a copy of her memoir, Horses in the Sand. And it's a fantastic, fantastic read. Thank you for watching, and thank you, Lorrie.
Oh, thanks, Crystal. It's been such a pleasure. I so appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you. Migwich.
Yes.
Bye.